Thank you very much, Edmund, for that. And thank you to everybody for coming along. It's a great pleasure to be here, a great honour to be with Zachary and Morris. I'm going to read a few poems from my book, Gish, and it's one to kick off with is a poem, I suppose, about the thing that makes us poets, which is a kind of affliction of obsession with language and love of language. This poem arose out of my idle reading of the dictionary, as I was wont to do in the days before it all went online. I now have the OED on my computer, and I'm much less likely to do it. But I was struck this week, also very moved by Bowie's passing, and there was a quotation circulating on social media, which said, attributed to Bowie, which said, "Don't you love the Oxford Dictionary? I used to think it was just a really, really long poem about everything." And I loved that. So this poem arises out of my reading of the section O, and it's called Ovum. Ovum. You'd take it for zero or nothing, or the spotless oval your lips make saying it, as if you blew both yolk and albumen through its pinpricked head, the meat of the word made orotund and latinate. It's like putting your mouth to the smooth breast of the ocarina from Oca, the goose, hooting out its fledgling notes. Unless you seal the gap it's left, they'll fall out, those other O words, like bubbles streaming through a soapy blowhole, from oblation and obloquy to oxlip and ozone. And that sneaky Trojan obol, coin-shaped, it's true, but spawned from the spiky Greek of obelos, the death mark, dagger, or crucifix. As phallic and obvious, now that you say it, as that double O in spermatozoan, which enters by its own locomotion, the flagellum, its tiny whip and scourge. I do have a running list here somewhere. The next one, I suppose if that is a poem about an obsession with words, with language, the next poem is a kind of poem of longing for silence, which is the opposite of that. We haven't had much of this stuff this year because it's been so mild, but it's a poem about snow, and the main characteristic of snow for me is the silence, is the kind of dampening effect that it has, and the sense of a, almost like the dampers on the piano comes down and just sort of quietens everything. So it's simply called Snow. What is it to talk about silence? When I look up from my table, it will still be there, where it fell in the night, hurrying to congregate in the cone cast by the street lamp, and in the darkness, the others, unseen but legion. How bruised blue the shadows on the garden, and the frozen cobwebs snapped beneath their weight. In the park, we blundered across it, the quiet, in spite of its exclamatory outline on bare trees, down great hushed halls of white, and the white lake picked out in kanji by the moorhen's feet. Are there words for what I felt in the faceted garden? Motes, corpuscles, animalcules. And it is a relief to feel it touch me with its meaning, its vast multitudinous silence, again and again. The next poem is, I think of as a companion piece for you to that. It's also a short lyric. And this poem was inspired by receiving a mail shot from Greenpeace of a really pathetic photograph of a polar bear which had died from starvation and exhaustion after swimming and not finding food for many miles because of the melting of its habitat. And I felt really impotent rage, and I thought, well, I'll write a poem about it then. Take that. So this is about that. I tried to think of it in terms of a kind of genius loci, a spirit of place, really, as these animals, kind of totemic animals, are. The reference to the Chukchi at the end, the Chukchi are one of the First Nations, the people, indigenous people who live around the Arctic Circle. And they had a ceremony whenever they killed a bear, whenever they hunted a bear, to do honor to the bear, to the spirit of the bear, by burying its skull facing north. And this is called Polar. It has a short epigraph. The US Geological Survey predicts 2/3 of the world's polar bears will disappear by 2050. By means of this, the photon is deflected into darkness, our white heat leaking from us. A great absconded god of emptiness hunted the groaning flows, scattering waves and particles from his coat, his hair hollow as birds' bones. Intervals of immense glittering distance. Then the animal heat of fur, of blood and membrane, and hot breath, the black-tongued breath of the sea. He tasted the breath of whales. He haunted the boundaries, ice rim and earth rim, the whetstone sky on which sense sharpened, on which his breath hung its own strange statues. Mage of the Edge, who knew his material in all its aspects, this yearly raising of dense liquid to frazzle, nylas, and pack ice, its boundless transformations. Always, he was equal to the whiteness of his kingdom, totem and newman, to a universe now present, now absent. Who will bury him like the Chukchi, his huge head indicating true north, amid libations and the pouring out of oil? The next poem I would like to read, I recently encountered this. I'm very interested in ideas about technologies, especially obsolete technologies and cultures. And this poem was inspired by a consideration of something called the Antikythera mechanism, of which you may have heard. It's basically it was discovered, I think about 100 years ago, at the bottom of the sea of the island of Antikythera, the Greek island of Antikythera. And it was found amidst a shipwreck of many, many wondrous things, statues, pieces of art and so on, and this strange little cake of something or other was also dredged up, and nobody knew what it was. And really it was only when X-ray techniques came in and archaeologists started to study it in earnest, I think in the 60s, and realised that in fact what it was essentially the world's first analogue computer. It was an immensely complex, sophisticated calculating device, which was used to predict solar eclipses, all sorts of things. So it's an amazing, amazing object. And there is an exhibition, I was recently in Athens for the first time, and there is an exhibition, a permanent exhibition at the Museum of Antiquities, which has the Antikythera mechanism. And I had written a poem about it, so it was very, very nice to actually finally get to see it. And this is kind of imagining imagining the Antikythera mechanism. The questions which are included in the penultimate stanza I've stolen from M.R. James's short story, Canon Albrecht's Scrapbook. The Antikythera mechanism. Too subtle to have been unique, a circular system of fine-toothed gears in cedar, its wheeled, delicate copper alloy movement, cranked by a handle, clicks and whirs so its incised texts rotate. This year, the color is black, or the color is fire red. Almost overlooked, dredged through starless ages by a sponge diver crippled by the bends, the sea-bitten glyphs, friable as icing, say that knowledge is dust almost. But this is the moon in a groove. No vagabond, but modest and observable in all her pale steps and lunations. Watching her narrow smile snagged on the needle tip of the cypress, or floating brokenly on a sea which admitted darkness but was never blue, must have suggested to him this gleaming planetary gearing, since to cast bronze is to pray, and to beat metal is to give praise. There was time in the town clair, town square clepsydra, but it trickled away. He could never step into it again. These were the loved hours, the poem of the moment, of pouring ripeness, when the breeze drove the flame of its exact pattern across the corn. Wallingford's world-famous astrolabe, Soussong's cosmic engine, all the beauty of escapements, mercury, grasshopper, or deadlock, even the ticking decay in 9 billion cesium cycles, interrogate, like this drowned analect of a mechanical age, ever more precisely the same silence. Shall I find it? Shall I become rich? Shall I live an object of envy? Shall I die in my bed? But nothing, since the nice-fingered craftsman of Corinth set the gear trains to a careful stargazer's design, has come close to an answer. Consult the oracle bones, cast the yarrow stalks, inhale the fine particles of your trade until they glitter in lung and bone. It is the distant ignition of stars, you, this clock, this dust, the yes, no, no, yes of the pendulum. I want to read a small poem, which is a sort of fantasy poem, which arose out of a stint of back-to-back watching box sets of The West Wing in a really, really dreary, drizzly November a couple of years ago. And there is one episode where they all decamp to the heartland of the USA, which always seems to be, for some reason, Iowa. That's the real America. And for some reason, I just thought of, I had a sort of fantasy of what Iowa might be like. I'm sure it has no bearing on reality whatsoever. And it was kind of inspired by an American student of mine who was also from Iowa and spoke about the cornfields stretching to the horizon and so on. So this poem is about Iowa, or more to the point, it's about my sort of fantasy of Iowa. It's called An Idea of Iowa. Who in their bleakest hour has not considered Iowa? We live in a place where everything leans in as if to confide in us and learn, too late, it is a trick. The freeze, the whole entablature must topple, as the drunk on the bus in the course of his life story anoints us with cidery spittle, as the ash from 1,000 fag end sunsets settles on us. But Iowa, a darkening indigo shimmer above tracts of corn, yellow as far as the eye can see, yellow as the sun in a child's first drawing, as the sear of the bald eagle hanging with locked wings on thermals. Iowa is rising. Free of the dead weight of ice, it gains an inch a year, a vast loaf proving. Who first thought of it? Indian grass, prairie moonwort, the Pleistocene snail? A place where wars are fought for honey? Named for a people asleep, a people with dusty faces. Even its hills are so much dust. Loss, the millennial accumulation of cracked floodplains, winds. I want to end with a poem which is also, I guess, about technologies in a way, obsolete technologies. I became very interested in airships, zeppelins, a while ago, and it struck me as remarkable that they were once the cutting edge of air travel. When you consider it from this perspective, these remarkable structures floating around, filled with hydrogen, of all things. I don't think nowadays health and safety would be very keen on that idea. But at the time, it was the only way to travel, really. And it's amazing to think that they also flew around the world, in one case circumnavigated the globe. So this poem is also, I guess, a sort of fantasy about airships, and it attempts to sort of tell the story of airships. There's a reference at the end to the famous footage of the Hindenburg disaster and the really famous narrative of that, the live narrative of that. So it's called the Airship Era. They'd barely emerged from the deep green forests of that epauletted century. Geraniums bloomed on windowsills in Heidelberg. Student princes eyed the tavern keeper's daughter through the blonde foam of their tankards. The future must have seemed weightless as it came nosing through the clouds, smooth as a biblical fish, throwing its giant shadow on the seafloor, its thin gold beater's skin pressed back against its ribs, cloche-hatted women in fox furs waving through its observation windows. Composed of too much dream stuff to be echt materiel, shoals of them congregated silently over London in the moon's dark phases, concealed above clouds. Their crews were unnerved by crackling blue halos, eerie lightning shot from frostbitten fingers as they lowered spy baskets on trapeze wires below the cloud cover, taking careful soundings, then dropped their antique payloads on the gaping population. Those whom they did not kill scarcely believed in them, improbable contraptions, the parchment yellow color of old maps, vessels a rational traveler might have chosen a half century earlier to pursue daft, round-the-world steampunk wagers. But for them, the gilded aerialists in their giant dirigibles, the world remained a storybook unfolding endlessly in signs and wonders, over which they drifted in stylish acidity, Leviathan hunters, relaxed as Victorian naturalists. And up there, everything looked different, the borders absurd, the people in their witch-fearing villages as out of date as peasants in a medieval breviary. The mountains too seemed surpassable, offering an alternative angle on the sublime. Occasionally there was concern, a tear in the fabric hooked to a typhoon's tail above the China Sea or harried by storms across the Atlantic. But how lighter than air they were, They did not understand, as they fell continually upwards, how the nature of the element was the price of their rising, the assiduous atom seeking an exit, thronging the fabric of their cells. Witness was the privilege of the many. Newsreels captured the death of a star and, oh, the humanity, its last leisurely plummet in fire, its ashen armature. Thank you very much.